We use biochar in this greenhouse, and we're using biochar lots of ways. John described the biochar inoculant, the biochar the char growth concentrate. We use that for every seedling that we start. And we always have really gorgeous seedlings, and we've had really spectacular yields in general. But this, we started to use charcoal on a larger scale, and I just did math with John. He asked the question, I think we used roughly 8 tons of the acre. It seemed like we used very little when I thought about it, but when you do the math, we probably used about 8 tons to the acre.
Charcoal,
yeah. And we mixed it into compost, and we put 2/3 of a yard of that mix. It was very good compost. We make really good compost. We have a really good system. And we put 2/3 of a yard of that per 80-foot row. And we also did compost tea. We didn't do nearly as much compost tea as we've done other years, because when we do the compost tea, we make it at least 80 gallons at a time, and you cannot use 80 gallons in a greenhouse like this. You know? Well, you could, but it'd be ridiculous. So we only put it out when the weather was conducive, which means that it wasn't raining when we were putting it out. And if you live in Western North Carolina, you know how often we put it out this year. So normally it's a weekly process with us with compost tea. This year I think there were about 11 applications. So this got it every time, but it got 11 applications of compost tea over the summer. These plants have been in since, let's see, these went in early May, and they've been producing since early July, nonstop. There was a week where I picked them clean. I can see right now, I'll notice sometimes that a few get missed and they're getting yellow, and that sets seeds and I think it'll stop production. So I picked them totally clean, and I couldn't believe the very full case that was sitting there ready to go to the hungry 7 days later, not even 6 days later. You know, so that level of production all the time. You can see the height. We haven't measured them yet, but I think they're pushing 5.5 feet if you take the height of the bed into it, you know. Incredible production using that system. We'll walk over and look at the tomatoes, but I can tell you that some that we've taken out, Mountain Fresh Plus, which is one that's being trialed regularly by our char endeavors, right? John, his char grow trials he does at Virginia Tech, used Mountain Fresh Plus. It's a determinate tomato. They got quite tall for a determinate tomato. They were about that high. And that's really tall for a determinate tomato. And we got a yield, we tracked the Mountain Fresh Plus very carefully because that's one we've always been tracking. We got a yield of 21.5 pounds per plant. And that was of number one fruit. Now I thought that meant we must have had a lot more fruit, but I asked Marshall who was doing the track, and he said, no, Pat, there was virtually nothing but perfect fruit. And I want to give a little testimony of the fertility in here. As Carrie can tell you, I'm of the wait and see and take your time pest control system. I'm never willing to spray. I'm always waiting for nature to kick in. We still have a slight spider mite and whitefly infestation in here. There were times this summer when we were getting those yields with pretty heavy pressure. I've released predators for the spider mites. I've done nothing for the whiteflies yet. And despite that pressure, we're still getting these yields. These plants are still going on. You can see where the honeydew has caused the mold and all that, it's not really affecting production. We're still getting very impressive production. That's because of the fertility. Yeah. And the good news is that all the research shows that when you get that kind of pressure on the plants, there are more antioxidants in your food. As the plants struggle to resist those pests, they're actually producing more antioxidants. So this food is actually probably more nutritious than ones there are organic sprays we could have easily had complete control. But we get complete control by sacrificing the beneficials. So instead, we just are slowly watching and learning and seeing what's the threshold where we have to come in and spray. These plants have been treated with neem drenches about twice, which kills a whole lot of the pests, but not completely. So the Mountain Fresh tomatoes had that kind of pressure, perfect fruit, 21.5 pounds per plant. I realized when I told somebody recently, that's about a pound per point of cation exchange capacity, because when we tested this soil, our cation exchange capacity was 21.5. I tried to research it and couldn't find the information, but good old John Nilsson had the book right on his shelf, an old USDA handbook. And native prairie soils, the two ones that he could find examples of, came in at 25 and 26.4 or something like that. So this is like native virgin prairie soil. That's, I mean, it's not quite, but it's pushing it, you know. We're off by only, by about 20%, which is pretty impressive. And so, I don't want to say that it's just the biochar and the compost, though, because we also had pond muck that we put in the soil. The soil originally started as subsoil. If you look behind the biochar facility, there's a bank, and originally the whole property was there. So they took a whole lot of soil away from here to fill somewhere and level this. And so the soil that we started with is like probably cation exchange capacity of 0.05. I mean, just no organic matter at all. It's subsoil, very mineral and very sandy. And so we mixed that with the pond muck. The pond muck was 8% organic matter, which is off the charts for organic matter. I mean, Gaia Herb Farm has that. They got some of the best farmland in the country, but it's very, very rare. Usually if you have 2%, you're doing really well. So we mixed it 1/3 pond muck, 2/3 local native soil. And so then we got it down to something like, 2 2/3 organic matter, in the soil. And so not nearly as much, but still pretty high. So it was a very good soil to start with. And to that, we added the char and the compost, and that's why we're getting the results we're getting in here. There was, and I think it was a calcium deficiency when we did it, when we looked at our soil test. Are people familiar with the whole mineral balancing theories, all that, Kinsey and the people in Acres talk about mineral balancing? There's this whole concept of mineral balancing. It's a little controversial. Mark Schoenbeck, who's presented here, presented, and can you all hear me here behind me? Actually did a SARE grant where he couldn't prove that it mattered in the mountains, and he's persona non grata at any Acres conference. You never want to be Mark Schoenbeck at an Acres conference, because they'll just jump on you and get all excited about it. They really believe in it. I don't really know if it's important, but it's easy to do, so I try and do it. And basically, the soil balancers say you should have about someplace in the mid-60s for calcium and someplace in the high teens for magnesium, and then the rest should be your other minerals, right, for the mineral load in your soil. And we were off. This is about 55 on the calcium and someplace in the mid-teens for the magnesium. So we were off on that. The result, I think it was purely that, I suspect, I can't figure out what would happen otherwise, was our summer squash, it's perfect for restaurant market. If you're in the restaurant trade, you want that mineral deficiency. Because all we got was millions of little baby squash. They never matured. We had a fair amount of blossom end rot, and just like tons and tons of baby squash, it never got big. So there was something going on there, and we haven't figured out what it is. We did do a tissue test, and I just haven't heard what the results were, but I suspect that we would see that same imbalance in the leaves, and that's what caused that. Especially because of the blossom end rot, which is often associated with a calcium deficiency. But otherwise, except for that squash, everything that we've grown in here has been massively productive. As we go to look at the tomatoes, you'll see we'll pass an Italian parsley, which is now bolting. And so you might not be surprised that it's that high, but it's been that high for months. It's like this one plant and it's a shrub of Italian parsley. So something about the fruiting needs of squash caused that not to work because I think of that calcium deficiency. But aside from that, production's been off the charts in here.
Did you have bees in here?
Pardon?
Did you have bees in here to pollinate?
We get these walls come down. So they made fruit. They just never gotten any bigger than that. And there was a fair amount of blossom end rot. And like I said, if you're in the restaurant, some of the restaurants, that'd be a winner. You might want to reproduce that because they like that size. The other thing we did, and we only did it in 2 bays, because we put 1 bay into production as soon as it was ready. But the rest of this, and then you can go online and look at a video we did describing it. We did, instead of planting it right away to crops, we planted it to a mix of oilseed radish and Phacelia tanacetifolium. That's a pretty unknown cover crop, but a really wonderful one. It's in the same family as borage and comfrey. And why we use it is because those are all very deep-rooted plants. There was a little bit of a mess up when they're making the pad for this greenhouse, and they didn't level it at first. And that wasn't really going to work if we were trying to use radiant heat, because it would mean our tubing would be in all different places height-wise. So they had to come back in and level it, which meant there was a lot of machinery on this pad. And so we were worried about compaction. But we didn't want to try and use machinery to break compaction up in a greenhouse. So instead what we did was we grew oilseed radish. I mean, the roots of those can get like this deep, and they can be like that big. And we grew the Phacelia tanacetifolium. Yeah, that's it. That's a volunteer from last year. And then, but I don't know, we might see a few Phacelia sticking around. The tanacetifolium is Latin for tansy leaf. You know, so it's got a tansy looking leaf. And it's this amazing little wild, kind of wild. There is actually a wildflower that grows on Rome Mountain that's a Phacelia, but it's not this one. And in Europe, they grow it a whole lot because they think it really ups the biodiversity. The fun thing to know about it is it's not a legume, but it fixes nitrogen. Okay. So that's a little special. There are plants that do that, but for cover crop plants, it's the only one I know that does it. Okay. So we plant that, and we plant it rye. And we zone plant it. We plant it in the place where we're going to plant the plants. We did just the Phacelia and the oilseed radish. Then on the edges and in the paths, we did the rye. And so we got the soil broken open really nicely. It was very productive because of it, despite that. The truth is, however, we didn't do that in the middle one, and the plants didn't do particularly poorly there either. You know? So I don't know that it was necessary, but it was best practice, and we're always about best practice. We're always looking to get the very best practice. The greenhouse is pretty fancy. It's actually set up on computer to have curtains come over at night to hold the heat in. And because we had the option to try them, and we may well go to it. I know the char plant people are all kind of talking into it, but I want to wait a year and test the radiant heat first. But we don't have forced air heat in here, and that would be a lot easier on them. You know, it takes an awful lot of heat to try and heat the soil. How are we doing, Dan? What's the temp these days?
66, 68.
So we're still holding.
Yeah,
that's very good. That's very good. With the curtains working, probably that's helping.
Yeah.
Our goal is to try and just keep the temperature at 68 in the soil, which means eventually the eggplant will of course die, but it'll be quite late because with those curtains over, and that soil temperature at that temperature, it's going to have to get down probably into the teens before we lose the eggplant. Yeah.
How deep are the?
They're at 18 inches.
Pat, I'm sorry I didn't hear. How was it you worked the char compost in?
We just hand worked them in. We made these beds by hand.
Like a double shovel?
Well, actually, you know what? No, I take it back. Rocco, you power harrowed this, didn't you? We put the char on, and then we put the compost on, and then you just power harrowed it in, didn't you?
After we made the beds.
Yeah. We made the beds by hand, but then we laid the compost on top, and he used the power harrow. It didn't mix it very well either, because we never want to work the soil very much. So it still needs to be mixed, but we figured the microbes and the worms would do that, and as we put the plants in, you know, pull them out, stuff like that. It's already looking way more homogenized than it did at first,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, and that will happen over time. You know,
and it's not like we never use a power harrow, but we try. We're pretty much, as much as possible, we try to do low to no-till. You know, our goal is not to till. And so it's not going to get a whole lot more mixing, but it depends on what, you know, if you want to grow carrots, we might use the power harrow. But by and large, we're trying to just like fill the cover crop and plant the next things right in.
So late blight and verticillium and those kind of diseases where the outdoor, it was a travesty this year in terms of the weather. You had little or no.
We had no late blight that I know of in here. Rocco, did you know of any late blight? No.
Late blight, no.
No. And that's. That's probably also our spray program.
And verticillium is a big factor in eggplants. So.
Yeah, it is. And that's, you know, it's never near as big with organic. We actually had a year where about maybe 3% of our eggplants were dying. I tested it with Supergluci, our agent. We found out that's what it was. I ordered the 2-Bio, you know, I ordered the Trichogramma and the, what's the other one now? I ordered two fungi that were bioactive that would help to control it. We never had to use them, it just stopped on its own. because of the soil diversity. And likewise, for Tropical Capsici, it took a whole season for Tropical Capsici to make it two-thirds of the way up the cover bed. Sue said about 10 times in a conversation with me, if you don't know Tropical Capsici, it's the gut. It's like just, it's death to peppers and squash. And once it's in your soil, it doesn't go away. You get it through flooding. It's really a wicked, it's same family as late blight. It's a water mold. It's a Tropical. Really, really wicked fungus. And we have it in our garden. But when we were told we had it, Sue said about 10 times that your soil diversity must be incredible. Would it have taken that long for it to get that far? Usually it shows up and all the plants are dead real quick. But because there's so much light, it just doesn't move as quick. And that's a classic. I mean, Frank Lowe's and I still disagree on that. I talk about how I don't know any good organic growers that have fusarium problems with their basil. And he goes, oh no, well there's naturally suppressive soils, but it's not your sister's. I don't know, because it's always your organic growers that don't have the problem. I think maybe the naturally suppressive soils were made that way by growers, you know?
Intentional cultivators.
Yeah, right. There may be some that are, you know, that, you know, have real high organic matter that function that way anyways. But otherwise, I think it's the practices. So yeah, we did spray. We sprayed regularly. And there was late blight up at the houses on the hill, not that far away. But as soon as we found out that we had it, we took those plants away. You know, so we did everything we could to avoid it, but we got commercial tomatoes all around us, and they basically abandoned them, didn't they?
Right.
After the flooding. So I guarantee you they had tons of late blight out there. Yeah. But we didn't get it in here. We were in the dry. Yeah.
What was it that you, what product were you able to use to you know, keep that contained? What was the name of it?
We have a whole field day on that on the web page, so I won't go into it in great depth. I'll say it quickly, but you can get all the details there. We did a rotation including Serenade, Sonata. We used Regalia all the time. We used Double Nickel, which is both Regalia and Double Nickel raise the defenses of the plant. They don't kill the fungi, they just raise the defense of the plant. We use Double Nickel, I think, every third time because that's a new one. And we use compost tea regularly, you know. But not as regularly as sometimes, but still fairly often. We use the Serenade with the compost tea. I don't think we ever used copper in here. We did use copper outside a couple times. And we didn't have as great a success outside. Clearly keeping it dry really helps, you know?
Yeah.
And then was there anything else? No, I think that's it. Normally we would have done a rotation of copper in this, but we just never had the disease, so we didn't.
Well, I have to speak for genetic resistance in terms of the varieties that you planted as a major factor.
Absolutely.
In terms of your success.
Positively, we planted, I think in this greenhouse, did we grow any heirlooms in this greenhouse? We planted nothing but NCSU state genetic resistance. You know, all the Randy Gardner and his successor genetics are what we grew. We didn't mess with anything that was susceptible. So that absolutely has a huge piece to do with it. Thank you for reminding me of that. I don't want to fool anybody who's trying to make a living organically growing tomatoes. That is a very tough row to hoe. And I don't claim that I figured that one out. But I can tell you, off topic, and I'll get back on topic in a minute, we did have one application of compost tea this year that absolutely killed all of the early blight on the plants they were sprayed with. And then we tried to reproduce that and got near complete kill, but not perfectly complete kill. So it is possible to do that. Can we reproduce that? I got no idea. But we're sure going to try. We make no claims to best practice right here. These guys should be gone by now. But they were here, and they've been producing nonstop since early June. And as little as 3 weeks ago, a case of these went to the hungry. Now there were more you see that died off, you know. But I just couldn't believe there was still, and actually, I mean, there is still, you know.
There was a big one on the back side.
Yeah, I mean, there's still cucumbers here. It's just unbelievable that they're still producing this long, you know. It has to have something to do with the fertility. And I mean, of course, they have the, and still have the white fly and the spider mite pressure, but still.
How many years has this been in?
Brand new this year.
This year?
Yeah. Rocco, did we plant the first crops in here in February? or was it January?
I think it was late January.
Right? Late January, yeah. And we didn't try and put tomatoes in until March. But we did get tomatoes in here in March, late March, which is about 3 weeks earlier than we plant our greenhouse that doesn't have any heat. And this year we'll try for even earlier. So I think it's the soil we made and the char that we put in it. You know, basically we just created incredible fertility. We went from 0 to 60 like that, you know, boom. And these tomatoes are an example of that fertility. I mean, they've been in also since we planted them in April, right?
Yeah.
Early April. Early April. They went in the ground in early April. And I mean, they had a moment where they stopped producing, but now they're just totally in flower. And if we keep them from freezing, we'll be picking tons and tons of tomatoes again. You know, and we have picked, I mean, endless quantities of tomatoes from this. I mean, they're actually kind of onerous because they're all these little cherries and they
what
take forever to pick.
What was your spacing on the tomatoes?
We always do them at 2 foot. 2 foot, and we do a stake to each plant. So but next year we're gonna have cables and run them all on cables.
So that's a single row of plants? Or?
That's a single row of plants, yeah. That's one row. Yeah. Yeah. That's one row. And if you can find a dead ripe one, they're probably still wonderfully sweet and spectacular. Yeah, we actually had problems with them growing too high and breaking over. Yeah.
Well, and what you're looking at is they're about as twice as tall as... This is the top of the tomato. Like,
so it's falling over. We have to get... Down. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That's
there's different varieties. This is probably Smarty, I'm thinking right here. Is this Smarty? We have Smarty in here. We have Mountain Magic.
Mountain Magic. I used to know it. Smarty, Mountain Magic. Mountain Fresh?
Mountain Fresh is gone. We took those out, yeah.
Well, I don't know.
There are steaks buried in here somewhere.
Yeah, we should.
We do have great big steaks that should be easy to find, except for the jungle has covered them up. But Red Pearl is another one we grew. It's all the Randy Gardner and his successor, whose name I don't know, unfortunately. I wish I did. But it's all their genetics. It's all those resistant tomatoes, you know. We have Defiant in here. There's, what's the name of the one that makes the plum now? Plum Regal, is that it? Rocco, do you remember, is the paste one Plum Regal? I think it is.
I don't recall.
Yeah. But if you just look up in like Johnny's and those catalogs for the ones that say late blight resistant, those are the ones that are in here, you know? It's all those and just, I mean, they haven't missed a beat, even with the white fly and the spider mite pressure, just nonstop production. So we can go on the other side and look and see what else is to see in there, but I think actually we're coming close to the end. We can talk about the winter crops we have in for a minute.
See if you can find these worms.
So this is another one. This is not the one I was talking about, but this is another example of how big the Italian parsley's gotten. These peppers also were like peaking at about 5 feet, by the way. They're kind of falling over now. We're about ready to take them out. I said leave them in just for y'all to see them. But once again, if you stand them up, you know, that's about 5.5 feet. Well, it's even more than that. I'm 6 foot and it's about maybe 5 inches there. So it's close to 6 foot, you know, that they were at. And next year, all these guys are going to be hanging from cables because otherwise they fall over with it. We've just got such growth in here that we have to do that, you know? This, by the way, is another way that we're trying to not work the soil. I didn't want to work this soil, but I want to be able to direct seed it. So what we did is we came in, we nailed over to the knob, right? We just took that cover crop and nailed it. Just cut it as low as we possibly could. We scalped it and then drenched it with compost tea and then put drip down, came in and put leaves and straw, and that was about 3 weeks ago, and all the residue is gone. Now we can plant it like a perfect seed bed, having never worked it. Yeah. But ideally what we'll do first is take this off probably early next week and get the weeds and start flushing and then flame it. And then direct seed it so that we don't have a lot of weeds. You know, so low work, but plenty of time. You know, we're giving up crop time to do this. You know? But that's okay because we have another greenhouse already planted full of stuff. We're not in a hurry for this. We want this to come in late winter. And the longer I do it, the more I'm amazed at how flexible it is. I mean, there's this whole thing that there's only certain carrots you can grow through the light change and all that, they'll start bolting. My experience is they all work as long as you give. As soon as you see they're starting to bolt, cool. But you've still got nice carrots though. So we'll probably be planting carrots, I'm thinking here, sometime after Thanksgiving. We'll do carrots and beets and turnips probably in these three beds. And then those two far beds over there will be put into more winter greens and stuff like that. What we have in here is a few Brussels sprouts, baby white turnips, broccoli rabs, grazing mix, beets and chard. What's in here now? We'll probably also put some lettuce in here. This section here, when it goes down, will just be cover crop. It'll get the same cover crop treatment that these two sections got last year. But for next year, the goal, I think, is going to be to try to have that section be where heat-sensitive winter crops are growing. Then we'll have the capacity to try and seal this side off and use as little heat as possible and see if we can carry stuff through the winter, no matter how cold it gets, with the minimum amount of heat. You know? Our philosophy, and I really love that we all share this philosophy, is we're making tons of heat. Just because we're making tons of heat, we never want to waste it. We always want to find the kilns have force air, have heat blowing down on you, right? That's not coming from the retorts. That's coming from the solar system in the ceiling. There is heat in the floor, but you guys haven't even had to use it very much, have you? Yeah. The solar system doesn't, you know? So we're going to try to continually set it up that we have these things that can use heat and then go, oops, we don't need it. What's the next way we can use heat? So we're looking next at trying to cool food with the heat.
So Pat, why are there no woody fruit crops like blueberries, for example, that are very, very healthy? Does it not make any sense at all to try to grow them, to have an early crop of them?
We put them in a greenhouse. There's a whole program for raspberries. There's a whole program where they actually put the plants in a walk-in cooler, give it 2 hours early, and then put them in a heated greenhouse, and you're picking raspberries in like February. So that could definitely be done. You know, the problem that right now we're all reeling from the spotted wing Drosophila.
I know.
So we're kind of like not even looking at soft fruit till we figure that out. You know. But yeah, we intend to do that. We'll be looking at, we're going to grow everything. This greenhouse is all about experimentation. So we're going to try all different kinds of stuff.
Fungi also?
We already did that the year before last. I think that's on, is there a video of that? Are we ever getting videos or pictures on the web
of
our pots full of oyster mushrooms? And
yeah, there's some pictures of those. Yeah.
You can go on the web and see we did stacks of pots. We took big pots and filled them with sterilized straw. And ran them down a piece of rebar, and they were inoculated with oyster mushrooms. It's great to do the fungi in here because the fungi put carbon dioxide out. Plants give them the oxygen. That's right. That's what it was. Otherwise, they start to. If you don't have plants making oxygen, you have to pump a whole lot of air in there, and then you have to heat more because you have to pump the air. Because we had all the plants, we didn't have to worry about oxygen. The problem I had with those was once it got hot, we couldn't keep up with watering. They just dried out way too quick. You know. So to me, that's only a winter thing. Once it's time to water them, I'd rather move them into the woods. You know, I don't think there's any reason to have them. If you got the walls up and stuff, I mean, I guess you're not making some carbon dioxide for your plants, which I'd like to do, but the trouble with watering was way too hard.
Have you considered the peppers for a different growing cycle than the traditional? Is it a perennial?
Oh yeah, well that's what I say. Next year we're going to, see this year we know this is going to freeze them. We're not going to be able to heat the soil enough to keep the air with that warm, you know? So I wouldn't try that this year, but I'm thinking next year we will try to have this section here grow frost tender plants straight through the winter. Personally, sometime about the middle of December, I don't really care to eat tomatoes that's been growing. They just don't have enough flavor.
Peppers
is a different story.
Well, the reason I'm saying is that we overwintered pepper plants.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And the production the second year is dramatically larger than the first year. So that's why I'm wondering if you could, for example, come in, use some sort of a low tunnel, put a pipe down it, you know, and you're putting them in the fall.
Yes.
Not in the spring.
That's worth considering. That's a good idea.
Yeah. I mean, we used the Aji Dulce, you know, which is the really slow growing.
Yeah.
And I brought over a plant like this big, put it in the second year, and it had, you know, 500 peppers on it. And a heartbeat, you know, and it's because it had the big root structure. It needs the root structure.
Wow.
That's a good idea. We should try that.
Because all you got to do is keep black.
Yeah, exactly right. And see, we should be able to keep our soil above 60 anyways with a row cover over it. It's never going to freeze.
Yeah. And so if it's only...
Yeah, exactly. So that's actually a good plan. We can actually plan on cutting these guys back and they probably resprout too.
The other one. Yeah.
So maybe we'll just do that.
Actually this year, because you got them.
Yeah, right.
What do you lose?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, exactly. We can actually plant a cover crop around it. If it doesn't work, we can just let it go. You don't have any more questions. This is the official end. I mean, I could actually vote each crop in here. So, you know,